So welcome back. Let us continue the section 1B, which is the subsection properties and features of interfaces of the section interface of the chapter interfaces, lambda expressions, and inner classes. As usual, you can see in the description box all the information about this lesson, including the outline of this video. So let us begin the properties of interfaces as we have seen with the previous section, comparable and compared to. Interfaces are not classes, they cannot therefore be instantiated. You cannot use the operator new with the interface. You can never instantiate an interface. However, you can declare an interface variable. So it's totally okay to declare a comparable X variable and then to assign to X any instance of any class that implements comparable interface. So this is okay provided that employee class implements comparable. You can use the instance of operator. This operator we all have already seen it in the reflection section in the previous chapter. So instance of works well with the interfaces and it checks, it returns true whether the object implements this interface. So whether the object is an instance of a certain class that implements this interface. So if an object instance of comparable, and this is totally fine. Classes can implement multiple interfaces. This is the flexibility. And in this case, you separate the name of the interfaces by a comma. For example, the class employee will implement clonable and comparable, and you separate them by comma. The clonable interface will be the subject of the next subsection. You can also extend interfaces, and this is going from generality to specialization. For example, consider your interface movable. It is a public interface movable with one method, void method, double X, double Y. You provide the abscess and ordinate to which you want your object to move. Of course, this is an abstract public method inside the interface movable. You can specialize this feature and you can declare an interface which is called powered, which is a sub interface of movable. It means powered extends movable. And in this case, it inherits the move method and it specializes also by adding another public abstract method called miles per gallon. So here, any class that implements powered, of course, it implements movable by inheritance. So you can also, for interfaces, apply constants. For example, here we add to the powered interface a constant speed limit, which is of type double. And of course, when we say constant, it means public, static, and final. And then lastly, you can have default modifiers in an interface. And for the method, the default modifiers are methods are automatically public if you don't precise, and fields are always public, static, and final. You don't dream of having instance field inside an interface. So this is it. Interfaces and abstract class. You cannot have multiple inheritance in Java. However, a class can only extend a single class. However, each class can implement as many interfaces as it likes. So this is a maximum flexibility, maximum efficiency with a minimum complexity encountered and suffered from in the previous language. Just like C++ when you have multiple inheritance, etc. So this is the optimal, at least in the point of view of Java inventors. We move now to static and private method. As of Java 8, you are allowed to add static method to interfaces. And as of Java 9, methods in an interface can be private. So let's check this first point. No technical objection from the beginning. There were no technical objection that prevent us to allow static methods inside the interface, but the Java people didn't do it. because it was against the spirit of the interfaces app as abstract specification. Up to then, we didn't have implementation for static method, so every static method was included in a companion class. So we had interfaces and companion classes. What does it mean? For example, we had the interface collection, and we all know the companion class collections, and some of us name it utility class. This class contains all the static methods that should go to collections. We also have pass, passes, etc. Every class name that ends with S is usually a utility class, a companion class, a class that contains only static method to be used. So now, as of Java 8, you are allowed to add static methods to your interface. You don't need to the companion class. Example, you can construct paths to a file or directory from a URI or from a sequence of strings such as passes.get, etc., a sequence of string. So this was available before Java 8. It is always available. But now in Java 11, there are equivalent methods that are provided inside the path interface itself, just like so. Public interface path, and you have your class, your methods. Public static path of, the method of, which will return a path. This is the return type, which is an interface, nobody can object. And then you get your URI as parameter or the list of strings as parameter. So string first, string, ellipses, 3 points, it means more. So this is a variable number of parameters. And they are implemented now, since Java 11, they are implemented already in the interface, and the passes class is no longer necessary. It always exists for the old code to be always okay, but you don't need it anymore. So similarly, when you implement your own interfaces, think of using the static methods inside your interfaces in order to provide an implementation. And don't use any more companion class for utility methods. Let's talk about a little bit about private methods. You will wonder, since it's private, yes, of course it is defined because it's private, and private method can be static and can be an instance method. Since they are private, they can only be used in the methods of the interface itself because they are not seen outside this interface. Their use is therefore limited to being helper methods for the other methods of the interface, but they are useful. Let's move to default methods. Even if they are not private nor static, you can supply now a default implementation for any interface method inside the method. You must tag, though, the method with the default modifier, but this time you have to write the default word. So, public interface comparable, you can provide a default implementation for the compare to method by writing default in compare to return 0. So here in this case, you will consider that by default all elements are the same. Okay, this is not very useful, but this is how you can do it. Let's take now a useful example. Let's talk about iterator. Iterator is an interface for visiting elements in a data structure. You will see this iterator interface in detail in the next chapters. Okay, but for now, let's consider you have seen it in the design patterns or you know about it. So we will say that iterator is an interface that serves to visit elements in a data structure. Whether this data structure is a tree, is a set, is a list, etc., you can use an iterator to visit the elements. So this is the methods inside the iterator interface. It declares a hasNext, which returns a boolean. It declares a next method, and it declares a remove method. You need to know that everyone who will implement this interface, they by default will not directly implement remove unless it is really necessary in their iterator. So almost a majority of the classes that define an iterator will write and will define the method remove as a method which throws an unsupported operator exception. So the idea here is to use this feature, the default method feature, and put the default implementation inside the iterator. Of course, you can always override this default implementation to your own implementation. But in case you don't provide, the compiler will not complain about an abstract method left undefined. A default method can call other methods. Public interface collection, int size, which is an abstract method. And here is your default method int is empty, which will call size. And if size returns 0, so it will return, yes, this is empty. So this is a very wise default implementation that will be very okay if we use it. But in fact, this is not the case in the framework of collection, because the framework of collection has the abstract collection class, whose job is to, in fact, implement all the abstract method declared in the collection. And this job was before even Java 8. So before Java 8, we had abstract collection, and the things are left as is. But now this technique to provide an interface and then to provide an abstract class that implements all the methods of this interface, but leave the specific methods for the concrete classes, so that the concrete classes, instead of implementing the interface, they can now extend the abstract class and get advantage of the implemented methods. All this logic that we use to explain to students in the frameworks, this logic is obsolete now, because simply now you can provide a default method for the interface and no need for the abstract classes anymore. See how things evolved from a version to another. So this is very important technique for interface evolution. Why? Why default methods are a very important evolution? Why are they very important for the interface evolution? They are so because, consider this example. Adding a non-default method to an interface is not source compatible. Of course, if you have an interface, consider that you have the interface collection. Okay, and then you have this old class that somebody implemented and that implements this interface collection, and it was fine, bags works fine, and the collection works fine. And now suppose later in Java 8 you want to add a new method to the interface collection, okay, a new abstract method to the interface collection. You guessed it, bag class will not work anymore. Why? Because the compiler, if you compile it, the compiler will complain. He will tell you there is a stream method that is declared abstract in the collection and interface, and you didn't provide an implementation of this method. But you will say, but when I wrote bag, it was not here. He will tell you collection evolved. And then you can have the other scenario. You can say, I will not recompile my bag class. It worked fine. I will continue working with it. Yes, okay. But suppose in a client code, somebody invokes bag.stream because it has the right, because you declare your bag class to implement collection, and collection has evolved and it was recompiled. So again, here you will have a runtime exception because the method is not defined. So the solution for all this problem are the default method. If you want to add a stream method to the collection interface, and in order not to do problems for all the old classes that had already implemented this collection, you provide the default implementation within the interface itself. You don't have to recompile, or you can recompile, same, nothing will, no problems will be arise. So if stream method was not the default method, that class will no longer compile. And of course, more complication and details you can explain, and we have already explained this now. And let's see about the subject resolving method conflicts. resolving default method conflicts. So what the question here is, what happens if the exact same method is defined as a default method in one interface and then again as a method of a superclass or in another interface? So now problem arises. What if I have a class that implements two interfaces and both interfaces have a same method but with different default implementation, or with same default implementation, the subject is with a default implementation. So the compiler here, what he will do, which implementation he will adopt? And another question here also, what if a certain class inherits from another and implements a certain interface, and there are definitions for a same method inside the interface and the class. So what is, how do we resolve this? This is the question. Okay, there are two simple rules, two very, very simple rules. The first rule is called super classes win. I don't care of the interfaces if there is an implementation of the method in the super class, because you only have one super class, so the super class win. The second rule is also very, very simple. Interfaces classes, clashes. Interfaces clash. If you have two definitions for the same method in two super interfaces and you have a one subtype that inherits, that implements those two interfaces, well, the compiler will complain. He will tell you, I have already lots of problems to resolve. Just resolve this problem yourself, please. So if a superclass provides a concrete method, default method with the same name and parameter types are simply ignored. And the second rule, if an interface provides a default method to and another interface contains a method with the same name and a parameter type, default or not, okay, implemented or not, then you must resolve the conflict by overriding that method. Whether the two interfaces don't provide default implementation, it's okay. Either one provides a default implementation, the compiler will complain. So this is a code. Suppose you have here the class tester, which extends person and implements name. And person provides an implementation for the method string getNameReturn. Empty string, and the interface named also provide a default implementation for the same method getName, which returns string, and this in this case it returns the class name and the name and underscore and the hash code, anything, but any other implementation or same. So here the superclass wins simply. We don't look at the default implementation in the interface name because the person class wins because she is a superclass. The second example, interfaces class. Consider now that person is an interface and name is an interface, and the class tester implements both interfaces, whether one defined or no. If there is a default implementation, we have a clash. If neither interfaces provide a default implementation, no conflict. This is the same case as before Java 8. There is no conflict. You have to provide your implementation inside the class tester. But caution here with the object methods. Okay? Why? Because, as we have said, superclass wins. Superclass wins, and object methods are methods inside the super cosmic class object. So there is no use to provide a default implementation inside any interface for the object methods, because nobody will give a care for them. They will be always ignored, since object is the super class of all other classes. Finally, in this subsection, let's talk about callbacks. So the title is Interfaces and Callbacks. The callback pattern is a common pattern in the programming. You specify the action that should occur when a particular event happens. Let's take an example. We will use this example later in the next sections. So a Java Swing package contains a timer class that is useful if you want to be notified whenever a time interval has elapsed. So this you create a timer object and it will count whenever the time elapsed. When you construct a timer, you set the time interval that you are interested in and tell it for the timer object you construct, you will tell it during the construction what it should do whenever the time interval has elapsed. So how do you tell the timer what it should do? In Java, you don't have a function pointer. You just attach an object to the object. So in Java, you pass an object of some class. So this class must be of a certain type. How we precise the type? Here comes the role of the interfaces. You pass an object of a certain class that implements a certain interface. This is the role. This is much more flexible than passing a function, because if you pass an object, the object has instance fields and other methods, so you have more flexibility. So how do you tell the timer object what method to call inside this object? And the timer requires that you specify an object, for example, of time action listener. Action listener is an interface in the Java AWT, what happens? It has one method. If it has more than one method, also the timer will know which method to call for which event. So this is the action performed method, which take an action event parameter that you don't give yourself. It will be given to it whenever the event occurs, and which will return void. And this action listener interface declares this method as an abstract method. To print a message, add the tone, the time is the time, and followed by a beep every 10 seconds, for example. Let's use this example concept to print this message every 10 seconds, or every 1 second, or every the interval you want. You can write a class which implements the action listener interface, and of course you will implement the action performed method inside this class in order to print the message you want. System.out.println at the time the tone is, plus the measure in millisecond of this time, every time you get the current time, plus you beep. Okay, so you call the write methods in order to beep. And then you constructed your class, you have to now construct an object of this class. So you declare var listener equal new time printer, because this is your class name. Later we will see how to write all this thing in a more elegant way. And then you will pass your object, which you called listener, to the constructor of the timer object that you want to give the task to measure every 1000 milliseconds, and then to do what the listener object will tell him to do. How? Inside the action performed. So all of this we will see now inside the listing timer, and then we will check rapidly the action listener interface. And if you are interested, you can check also the interfaces, the Java doc of timer, of GOption pane, because we used here, and of toolkit, because we use also here. So let us go and check the code. This is our code, and this is exactly what we have been explaining. A new time printer. Where is time printer? This is the class time printer, which implements action listener and which gives the time in text and beeps. Let's run this text. Let's run this code, and you will get every 1 second your call until you quit on, until you click on OK to quit the program. So this is the callback. This is how it happens. You attach an object to a certain method, and then whenever the event happens, this object has the right method to be invoked. And this object, the thing here is that this object that you just attached is of type of a certain interface. So this is all about the subsection B inside the section interfaces, and next we will see the section C, which is clonable interface and object cloning. So stay tuned.